If you've never heard of the club called the Bilderbergers before, it's for only one reason. They haven't wanted you to know.
Hold on.
Why people?
No. Don't tell me what I'm going to say. Tell me about the Bilderberg Group. You know nothing about the Bilderberg Group, which your Prime Minister and your major owner of your newspapers is a member of. So's the British Prime Minister.
The media here won't cover it.
There's a conspiracy theory that a shadowy elite of bankers and businessmen and politicians and media moguls are secretly controlling the governments of the world.
They start the wars, they cause the famines, they control the governments, they choose the presidents, both candidates, they tell them what to do. They're setting up the one world order.
The theory goes that these elitists plan to create an all-powerful new world order, a world government that will destroy anyone who disobeys them.
If I could explain to you who they were from the top down, we could just get a whole bunch of rope and go hang a bunch of them.
And they're a despicable organization.
But now, some conspiracy theorists believe they've uncovered the name of the secret cabal. They say their cover is now blown, that they are called the Bilderberg Group.
So, isn't it funny that the Bilderberg Group seems to be rather influential? Tony Blair, Bilderberg Group. Gordon Brown, Bilderberg Group. Leading players in the present British government. Now, of course, the opposition chancellor to Gordon Brown was Kenneth Clark. Bilderberg Group. Let's look at the head of the World Bank, James Wolfensohn, Bilderberg Group. Let's look at the first two heads of the World Trade Organization, Peter D. Sutherland of Ireland and Renato Ruggiero of Italy, Bilderberg Group. Wherever you look, this thing comes up and no one's ever friggin' heard of it.
It was hard for me to believe what the Spotlight journalists were sure of, that every major international power shift could be traced back to this group that few people have ever heard of.
I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
Richard Nixon was forced out of office. A lot of people say that he was lucky to have survived with his life. They expedited John F. Kennedy's removal from office. But as I say, people speculated that they decided it would be too messy to have another president shot down in the streets of an American city.
So. Well, there's quite a laundry list. They seem to have their evil hands in most of the upheavals of the world. The Persian Gulf War, raising taxes in America. The downfall of Lady Thatcher as Prime Minister of Britain.
Now it's time for a new chapter to open, and I wish John Major all the luck in the world.
Jim says he once sidled up to Lady Thatcher and asked her how she felt about the Bilderberg Group orchestrating her downfall.
And her response, to be denounced by a Bilderberg, I consider it a tribute. Any head of state who would surrender his sovereignty to some international organization should not be head of state. She spoke very strongly about surrendering British sovereignty to the European Union. And that's why they manipulated to kick her out and replace her with a trapeze artist from her own party. And of course now Tony Blair, who attends Bilderberg meetings and receives his orders.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.
In her going, she discovered to her that a British Prime Minister cannot govern without the consent and support of colleagues.
Yeah, chilling time.
Then, incredibly, at 5 p.m, something began to happen. Later, I managed to get a copy of the guest list, the names of the men who really did roll past us up the drive of the Caesar Park that day. There was Umberto Agnelli, chairman of Fiat. There was Paul Allaire, chairman of Xerox. There was Conrad Black, chairman of the Daily Telegraph. There was Kenneth Clark. There was Donald Graham, publisher of the Washington Post. There was Richard Holbrook, ambassador to the United Nations. There was Henry Kissinger. There was Peter Mandelson. There was William McDonough, president of the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. There were CEOs of Nokia and SmithKline Beecham. There was David Rockefeller, chairman of the Chase Manhattan Bank. There was Robert Shapiro, CEO of Monsanto. And there was James Wolfensohn, president of the World Bank.
They're inside. the scene of the crime now, planning the crimes.
So it was all the more incredible that after months of trying, I was suddenly invited to meet the Secretary General of the Bilderberg Group, a secret ruler of the world himself, should you believe the conspiracy theorists.
But you have done very well in keeping Bilderberg out of the public consciousness. There's
Thank
no
you.
Denying that. And that's what you wanted to do, is keep it out of the public consciousness.
We don't... I don't think it's true to say that we want to keep it out. We've never wanted to get it in. We don't encourage people to mention it in the mainstream press because we don't encourage, idle speculation about what we do. We forbid individual attendees to give press meetings at our conferences. And we do that not because we're secrecy mad, but because we want to control the politicians who come. I mean, if we let them, they would all give press conferences. They all want to be on television every day. You know, they're insane.
You can't get people to talk honestly to one another, especially in front of political opponents in their own country, if they're going to be quoted, because people will only talk freely if they know they're not going to be quoted and distorted by prurient, ambitious journalists like you.
It's a private organisation, and we live in an age which can't distinguish privacy from secrecy. And privacy is then seen as secrecy, and secrecy is sinister by definition.
Why are you happy to talk about it?
Because you asked me. Especially if I'm answering claptrap from idiots who have no knowledge of it, but think they can improve their public image by attacking it.
An appropriate venue is a comfortable, but not necessarily luxurious, hotel, which is remote and peaceful, but not too far from a major airport. And there aren't many of those. We invite people to come to the meeting and we organise the panels. And somebody orders the wine and food.
So are you like a headhunter? Because a lot of people who've been to Bilderberg have gone on to be president or prime minister.
Tony Blair came the year I first went, 93, that's right. And Bill Clinton a couple of years before he became president. We're looking for people who are thoughtful, either are or are going to be influential. I don't think we're as good at talent spotting as you suggest, actually.
Conspiracy theorists, of course, say that it's not about talent spotting, it's about bringing these people in and then making them the next president or prime minister.
If the conspiracy theorists saw the difficulty we had in actually organising a meeting, I don't think they would credit us with such supernatural powers.
It was never a policy-making organisation. It was always a policy-discussing organisation. David Rockefeller was involved, Henry Kissinger also, Jack Hines, who was the head of the Hines Baked Beans Corporation. And it was a way of bringing together politicians, industrialists, financiers and journalists from the whole of the Western world to talk about things so that they had a better feel for one another's attitudes. And as you know, politics should involve people who are not politicians.
Yeah, well, I think he made a mistake by being so secret at the early stages. And I think initially there was a lot of secrecy. But secrecy is rather stupid. And I think Bilderberg would probably agree that they made a mistake. And some of the business people get rather carried away, and old Henry Kissinger arrives with his security posse and everything like this. But it does have a serious element in that some of these people have actually had their lives threatened.
Conspiracy theorists say that the ultimate Bilderberg agenda is a one-world government.
I think that's exaggerated, but not totally unfair, in the sense that those of us in Bilderberg really felt that we couldn't go on forever fighting one another for nothing and killing people and rendering millions homeless. And to the extent that we could have a single community throughout the world would be a good thing.
Does it help a career to go to a Bilderberg meeting?
No, I don't think going helped your career. I think, in a way, when you got a job, you had more influence in the global field.
Isn't that in some way a conspiracy?
Oh, come off it, dear boy. look, you get on in the BBC because you suck up to the people who will say, look, go and talk to Dennis Healy.
Channel 4.
Yes, that's right. Essentially. Oh, no, Channel 4, even worse, because that's commercial. I mean, you might as well say you're trying to promote the interests of the people who advertise on Channel 4. Even I don't believe that.
As always in conferences of this kind, many of the most important interactions take place privately at the breakfast table.
Hearing the Bilderbergers talk made me wonder whether they were a conspiracy and they just didn't realise that they were.
People who are there and talk privately at a dinner deserve to have their conferences respected. For me, the value has been building a group of friends, a network, if you like, and people who I've come to know and have come to know me.
In the end, maybe the secret room is no more than a place to network, just like any golf club. Is this a good thing or a bad thing? It depends on whether you're a member of the golf club. The conspiracy theorists are right. The New World Order exists, although we have a different name for it.
They're by and large internationalists. The business people tend to come from the bigger international companies, and it is very sensible.
But that is the world. That is the way it happens in the world, and quite rightly so. What's wrong with that?
And what happens to those people who oppose this New World Order? They're like twigs in the tidal wave.
If you don't have the right attitude, if you don't have the right belief system, you can be put up against a wall by these people. That's what they do.
People who went to Bilderberg meetings as many times as Dennis Healy, including the first one, there's no way they don't know what it's really about. No way.
Many photographs inside Bilderberg meetings. I felt we were getting along well. We were fellow globalists, and I was anxious to see his photographs, see the mood, the faces.
Have you got any in a nearby album we could see?
No. F*** off.